Steve, did we have any wigwams in Monrovia?
I don't think so. However, in Arcadia, on Route 66 that was originally established in 1926, was a roadside stand called the Wigwam. I've seen postcards of it, and it didn't look like a wigwam. It looked more like a South Seas island hut, because I think there were palm fronds. Anyway, they sold fruit juices. And it was also associated with the Slemons family, who produced lots and lots of citrus juices for various schools and businesses around Southern California. So they had the plant that I think was on the same premises, maybe behind the roadside stand, not on Foothill, was the Wigwam. It was located at 141 East Foothill Boulevard. The Slemons family I mentioned. By 1935, the Arcadia City Directory indicates that the Wigwam was vacant. But by 1937, it was listed as the business location for one Patrick J. McDonald, who sold fruit juices and who was living in Glendora. Let's go back a while. Patrick McDonald and his wife Margaret were both from Ireland. Actually, I think they said they were from the Irish Free State. They emigrated to the United States. They settled in Manchester, New Hampshire. They had a family of five children, two sons and three daughters. Their second oldest was Maurice McDonald, born in 1902, and the next to the youngest was Richard McDonald, born in 1909. They were there in 1920, but by 1930, Maurice and Richard were nowhere to be found, at least not in the census record, and I haven't a clue where they were. Maybe bumming around the country, who knows, it was the Depression, they may have been unemployed, maybe they said, let's seek our fortunes out west. Anyway, I don't know where they were between 1920 and 1935. However, the parents, I did find the parents still in Manchester in 1930, but by 1935, they had all ended up in Glendora. Now, I don't have any street information for them, but the 1940 census, they stated, the question was, where were you living in 1935? And they all uniformly said Glendora. So Glendora was a huge citrus center at that time, with a packing house, maybe more than one packing house, producing lots and lots of oranges. So the McDonalds, whatever they were doing, were aware of oranges, or a source of oranges. Richard met a young lady by the name of Marjorie Baird Comstock, who was a 1934 graduate of Citrus Union High School. At that time, Citrus Union High School took in the districts of both Azusa and Glendora, and the high school campus was located where Citrus Community College is today. So they must have met in Glendora. She graduated in 1934. The McDonald family arrived in Glendora in 1935, and in 1937, Richard and Marjorie were married in Carson City, Nevada, the same year that McDonald's was established in Monrovia. Interesting sideline. One of the women, one of the people associated with the 1937 roadside stand that the McDonald's named the Airdrome because of its close proximity to Monrovia Airport, was a woman by the name of Mildred Kobzeff. Her nickname was Skeeter. Her maiden name was Mildred McCaskill. Her married name was Kobzeff. But in correspondence between Richard McDonald and Gary Bowen, there's a mention of Mildred, and apparently Mildred was the one who enabled Gary Bowen to get in touch with Richard McDonald back in New Hampshire. My guess is that when the McDonalds started the Airdrome in 1937, Mildred found out, maybe because she was a friend of Marjorie, and that's why she happened to go to work for the McDonald's at the Airdrome in 1937 and maintained contact with them the rest of their lives. They established the Airdrome in 1937. is on the south side of Huntington Drive, immediately north of the airport itself, which did not run all the way north to Huntington. It stopped at a little street called Fallen Leaf, a name that was a residual from the time when Huntington Drive was named Falling Leaf Avenue. It was about 7:46. The block between Shamrock and Mount is a long one. It actually is two blocks long. And I believe that the orange juice stand and hamburgers and whatever else they chose to serve was probably about midway through that long block. So about 7:46.
East Huntington.
About the same time, and I'm saying about the same time because I'm referring to correspondence from Richard McDonald to Gary Bowen, in which he mentions their second stand, which was the Giant Orange, was on the north side, and I believe it was further west in the 700 block of East Huntington Drive, if I just muddied that up, I'm sorry, closer to Shamrock. And I say that because some of the pictures of the airport would lead you to believe that it was a little further west on Huntington and closer to Shamrock. The Giant Orange sold orange juice, obviously, hamburgers, hot dogs, and one of the two locations sold beer. Remember, Prohibition ended in 1933, so it was perfectly okay to be serving beer at a roadside stand. And Richard McDonald's explanation was that they had locations on both sides of Huntington Drive because they wanted to catch the traffic eastbound and westbound on Huntington Drive, which was part of Route 66. In terms of their oranges, it's my personal guess that because of their living in Glendora and their being familiar with the citrus industry there, that they may have tapped the Glendora packing houses to provide them with oranges that were not suitable for packing and shipping. They might have been a blemish in the skin, something that would impact their marketability in terms of their orange juice and their quality. Interior, they were probably perfectly okay for juicing purposes. So I don't know that for sure, but my guess is that their source was from Glendora. Because of having lived there, they had associations.
So is it accurate to say that these McDonald brothers began selling orange juice, and oh, by the way, why don't we sell hot dogs and hamburgers to go along with the drinks?
What Richard said was, or what maybe the Wikipedia article says, that the McDonald's were inspired by a hot dog stand that apparently was seasonally busy because of Santa Anita racetrack traffic. So they got the idea, but they augmented it by orange juice and maybe French fries, whatever else they might have added to their menu. And their goal, of course, was to be viable year-round and not just seasonally based on the traffic associated with Santa Anita.
But it is the case that this is their very first, these two are their very first stands.
Their very first roadside stands.
Or restaurants of any kind.
Yeah, except I wouldn't refer to them as a restaurant in that there was not an enclosed space to eat. It was all open. I believe there were stools to sit on, but I don't think there was any enclosed dining area.
But these are their first.
These are their first. They employed car hops. I believe that Mildred Skeeter Kobzeff was employed as a car hop. One of the articles I read mentioned that the majority of their early customers were young men who came so they could flirt with the car hops. And the McDonald's, they had nothing against romance, but they found out it slowed down their operation considerably if the car hops were out there yakking with the young men and flirting. By 1940, they decided they needed a different market. And so they decided San Bernardino was a possible location. San Bernardino had a population at that time of about 100,000. The population was largely working class, who would be looking for a reasonable place to get fast food. the TED workmen come, they cut the aerodrome in two pieces and towed it off to San Bernardino, where it was reassembled, renovated, and reopened, this time under their name. It was under the McDonald name. Before, they just used the aerodrome as a catchy name because of its proximity to the airport. Richard McDonald stated that at the same time they moved the aerodrome, they sold the Giant Orange, but he couldn't remember 40 or 50 years later exactly who bought it and where it went. But they did sell it. So that got them to San Bernardino in 1940. Their father stayed in Monrovia, even though his two sons moved to San Bernardino when they moved the aerodrome. He stayed in Monrovia and operated the wigwam until his death in 1943. Now, there's no sight of the wigwam now. It's long gone, but there is a street in Arcadia named Wigwam after the wigwam location. As a follow-up, Ray Kroc joined the brothers in 1955. They began to franchise the operation, and in 1961, Ray Kroc bought out the McDonald brothers' interests, and they were no longer part of McDonald's. The closing thought. The irony of the situation is that the McDonald's in Arcadia, on the north side of Foothill, is probably sitting smack dab on the site of the Wigwam roadside stand. So the combination between McDonald's and the McDonald brothers exists today in Arcadia.